Hi everyone, welcome to our second lecture on binary search trees. So I decided that we actually will start with the application of binary search trees, then actually the visualization and the iterator. So we'll start with Huffman coding, which is basically an encoding that makes every text into a smaller, a compressed version. So if we send a message over the internet, every character will be encoded in 8 bits, or if it's Unicode, it will be encoded in UTF-16 into 2 bytes or 16 bits, or it would be encoded in 4 bytes in UTF-32. So really, the problem is that when you send characters over the internet, they take a lot of space. And that also means time to send all of these characters over the internet. Huffman coding compresses the data into fewer bits to encode more frequently occurring characters. So just to give you an example, if we are going to encode Mississippi into binary using the Huffman coding, and then we can still decode it into Mississippi, but we can send it into a less number of bytes. We can send it into 4 bytes or 3 bytes instead of sending it over 12 or even more bytes. So really, it's an encoding scheme that compresses data into smaller, bytes. And these character codes are actually constructed using binary trees. And these type of binary trees are called Huffman coding trees. Now, just to tell you a little bit about the history of Huffman coding, when David Huffman was a student at MIT, he was given the choice of a term paper or basically a final exam. And the term paper was to find the most efficient binary code. And initially he was unable to find such codes that are more efficient, most efficient, and he was ready to give up. And then he basically guessed the idea that we are going to talk about today and prove that this is the most efficient way to send encodings over the internet. Now, it's a greedy encoding, so it's not always optimal, but it's very, very close to optimal. So let's talk about the Huffman coding. And this is quite a common story. Danzig, basically when he invented the simplex method for integer programming, he also thought that is an assignment. The story there is that he basically came late to the class. The professor was talking about a problem that was unsolved, a conjecture in his mind, and Danzig thought that is an assignment. So he worked hard and he invented the simplex method and he submitted it as the as a homework assignment. So basically the idea of Huffman coding is that you develop a binary tree where every edge in the binary tree is labeled with 0 or 1. The left edge, the left child is labeled with 0, the right child is labeled with 1. Each character will be a tree, will be a leaf in the tree. So M is basically this leaf, P is this leaf, S is this leaf, I is this leaf. The higher the character is in the tree has a shorter encoding, because every character will have the as encoding the path from that character to the root of the tree. So the code of a character consists of the edge value in the path from that leaf or from the root to the leaf. We can also do reverse encoding from the leaf to the node. So for instance, the letter M will have 0, 0, 0 encoding. The letter P will have 0, 0, 1 encoding, and so on. So every basically leaf, every letter will have the encoding for the path from the root to that node. And it's based on the frequency. So letters like I that appear many times in the text, like in Mississippi appears 4 times, will have a higher, will have a shorter path from the root to that node. For letters that appear less frequently, that we have a longer path in the tree. So this shows that since we build this tree, and this is the tree that we will build for Huffman coding, and the tree is non-deterministic. So there are letters like P and M that appear both 4 times. So they can basically be interchanged in the tree. But basically, once we have such a Huffman tree, we can read every character instead of having the character in the string, we have its encoding. So for M, we would have 3 zeros. For I, we would have the path from the root to I, which is just 1, 1. For S, we will have 0, 1, and so on. Every S will basically be encoded into 0, 1. Then I will be encoded into 1 again. Then the next S is encoded as 0, 1. And so on. So basically we build this tree, and then based on the tree, we can encode the text into bits, and vice versa. We can actually take the encoding, like for instance, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 will basically be 0, 0, 0, 0, which is M. Then for 1, we come back to the root and we read 1 is I, and so on. So we can do both encoding and decoding using the same tree of text into binary and from binary into text. And again, this does a lot of compression, because instead of having 12 to 14 characters here, we basically have binary, 3 bytes in this example, 3 or 4 bytes. So how do we construct this Huffman tree? This is the secret. It's a greedy algorithm. And if you remember, we talked about greedy algorithms when we talked about data structures and algorithms earlier this semester. And the idea of a greedy heuristic is that we always make the locally optimal choice at every stage. And in many problems, this greedy strategy doesn't produce an optimal solution and doesn't produce an optimal solution in Huffman coding either. It will give you a very approximate close value to the optimal solution. So in the case of Huffman encoding, if we transmit, let's say 3000 bits over the internet, and it's not optimal, optimal would be 2990, it doesn't really matter. Those 10 additional bits is very low. And there are other encodings like alternate encoding and arithmetic encodings that may be optimal. But Huffman encoding is very simple and very easy to implement, and is very, very close to optimal. So the algorithm is very, very simple. Basically, first we create one tree for every character. And the tree is labeled with the weight of that character, the frequency of that character in the training text. So we take a training text, we basically count how many times A is in the text, how many times B is in the text, and so on. For those that have a weight greater than 0, we basically build a tree with for that weight. Then we repeat the following step until there is a single tree. We put all of the trees that we saw before into a priority queue. We are going to implement it with a heap. So basically, the trees that have a higher frequency will be on the bottom of the heap, and the trees that have lower frequency at the top of the heap. We basically reverse the comparison. So the priority queue will always choose the 2 trees that have the lowest possible frequency. Now, there are trees with equal frequency. They will be ordered in the same tree. So in the same queue. So you will choose, we always choose the first 2 trees with the smallest weight, and then we create a new node basically, which is their parent, and the weight of that tree is the sum of the two trees that we had before. So the weights of the two trees, we sum them into a new parent, which will create a new tree. And we push it back onto the priority queue. Then, so the weight of this new tree is the sum of the weights of the subtrees, and we push it back on the priority queue. And that's the entire algorithm. So let me show you this example. We take Mississippi. It has the letters M, capital M, lowercase s, lowercase I, lowercase p. And we have one M, four S's, four I's, and two P's. We put them in the priority queue. So on the priority queue, basically the two nodes that have the lowest weight are M and P. So it will pop the two the two trees from the priority queue, and it creates a new tree of weight of three, which is the sum of weights of one and two. Now, we can choose either one of the next two trees as being the second tree that will be chosen from the priority queue. So we have three and four, and of course, we'll choose three and four, and we create a new tree that has a weight of seven. In the priority queue now, we have four as the minimum and seven as the second one. So again, we basically combine them into a tree which has four and seven as the children. And we can put them in either order that we want. We can actually swap four with seven. We always put the minimum as the left subtree, but it's not really necessary because the encoding is the same, no matter if you swap them or not. So now we have the Huffman tree, which has a weight of 11. And for every letter, we basically have a leaf in this tree. So now the implementation. So the Huffman code, basically it has a main method that reads a text. We enter the text from the command line. It creates an array counts, an array of integers, which counts the frequency for every single character that we have, and returns that array of frequencies. We count the frequencies. Now, the way that actually this array is built is the 256 characters in ASCII, and we have the frequency for every one of them. And I'm going to print the ASCII code, and then the character, the frequency of that character, and the corresponding code. Huffman tree will basically be the tree that we are creating for that those frequencies. So get Huffman tree will be a method that we'll implement later, and it returns a Huffman tree. And then the codes are all the codes obtained from the Huffman tree, which basically iterates over the tree, the leaves in the tree, and for every leaf, it prints those frequencies. It prints the ASCII code, the character, the frequency, and the code. And we do that in a for loop that iterates over all the codes. If the code is different than zero, so basically we ignore the codes in that array that are different than zero, we print the character, the encoding, the codes for that character. And it will print something like this. Basically, if I enter welcome, it prints that it contains W with a frequency of one, and the corresponding code in the tree is 110. C has the ASCII code of 99, and the frequency is one, and has the code 111, and so on. Now, how do we get the frequencies? So this array counts is really just an array with 256 positions. A position corresponding to every ASCII code from zero to 255. And we iterate over the text. So the text that was passed as an input, we iterate with indices I from zero to the length of the text. And we increment the corresponding element in the array at index, the character at index code in ASCII, we increment it with one. So really it contains, it's like a bitmap. For every character in the alphabet from zero to 256 in ASCII, it basically contains the counts of that character. how many times that character was in the text, and we return this array of counts. So it works for punctuation signs, for lowercase letters, for uppercase letters, and so on. We want the string to be exactly in the same way encoded at input and at decoding. Okay. So now, how do we implement basically? So first of all, we have this public static Huffman tree, get Huffman tree, that takes the counts and it creates the Huffman tree corresponding to those counts. So how do we do it? First, we create a priority queue implemented with a heap. So the heap is the same heap that we had in two classes ago when we talked about sorting. And basically it implements basically sorting through a heap. And it's a heap of objects, a heap of Huffman tree objects. For every count object, if the count is greater than zero in that array of frequencies, we add to the heap a new Huffman tree for corresponding to the counts and the character. So it's basically a new leaf in a new single leaf node tree, which is added to this heap. And the heap is basically sorted. This Huffman tree implements comparable, and we are sorting it by weight, reversed by weight. I will describe it when we get there. While the heap size is greater than one, I remove the maximum, which is basically the minimum node, the top of the heap. And of course, this will do a reordering of the heap. We take the last node in the heap, we put it as the root, and then it's basically exchanged with the maximum of his children. In this case, it's a minimum heap, so with the minimum of his children. So once we get both the smallest nodes, so we get basically the smallest and the next smallest after we arrange the heap, we create a new Huffman tree with those two trees, which basically combines the two trees with a single root, and it basically has as left child T1 and as right child T2. So we do this operation until we have a single element in the heap, and at that moment we remove that element and we return it. And that's the Huffman tree that we return to Huffman encoding, this previous method. Okay, so now Huffman tree implementation. So Huffman tree implements comparable, and it has two constructors that we will see. One is one constructor that creates a Huffman tree with a single node of the weight and what is the element in the Huffman tree, the character that we are counting. The compare to method is implemented that if the weight of the root of the current tree is less than the weight of the root of the tree T, then we return a positive value. So we prefer smaller trees at the beginning of the, we consider them bigger from the point of view of the comparison of these trees in the heap. If the two trees have the same weight, then we return zero, that they have the same weight. Otherwise we return minus one. The second constructor for Huffman tree, as I said, it creates a new Huffman node, which is another class that we'll discuss next. And it creates for this Huffman node, this is a standard tree that has a left branch and a right branch, also trees. And the root of the right, the left branch is, the root of T1 will be the left branch, the root of T2 will be the right branch. The weight of the root will be the sums of the weights of the two roots of T1 and T2. So what is a Huffman node? A Huffman node is basically the element for which we create this Huffman node, like the current letter that we are going to put in the leaf. The weight of that leaf, so it's basically in the case of a subtree, of a tree will be the sum of the weights of the two children. And then we have the normal tree references, a reference to Huffman node and a left, and another reference to Huffman node right. So, and then we'll basically also store the encoding, because we want not to pass the tree for every single time that we need a letter. We'll basically store this path of how do we get from the root to the current node into a string that is in that node. So the Huffman node constructor basically has a public empty constructor and another constructor that, given the weight and the element, it assigns to those two data fields the correct values. GetCode is a method that takes a Huffman tree node, like for instance the root of a Huffman tree, and returns an array of strings of basically the, again, for 256 characters, for every character in the ASCII code, what's the corresponding code will be in that indexed variable. So we use as an index the ASCII code of the character, and the code will basically be the string that is attached to that ASCII code. And for doing that, we call the assign code method, which basically takes the tree and the codes, and we return the codes. Now, how do these codes get assigned? For every node, so we start from the root. The root has empty string as the encoding. For every node, the left tree code will be the root code plus the empty string. And we assign, we call the same method, assign codes, for now the left subtree and the same array codes. And we do exactly the same for the right subtree. Basically the right code, the right child code will be the root code plus one. And then we call assign code for that node, the right child, and the same array codes. Otherwise, if the left tree is not different than null, we basically, the codes of the root element is the code of the current root element, which is basically the ASCII code of that node that is currently in the root, in the current element, will be the root code. So let me actually show you how this works. So I implemented Huffman code here, and it's exactly that method that you saw in the code, in the text. Let's say all folder, which is CSC 260, and now we describe what 260 is, computer science honors B. And what it basically did, it built a tree, and then for every character that had an encoding different than zero, the frequency different than zero, it gave me the codes, okay? Now, if I do want to encode it, the method to encode it is quite simple. Let's actually continue this method. So up to now, we just printed the encodings, but normally I should generate the encoding and then show that encoding. So let's create a string encoded. Initially is empty. And then for every integer, actually every character C in text to character array. So basically we get for every character, we'll want to get its encoding. So encoded is concatenated with codes of C. Okay, so now in encoded, I have the encoded string. So for instance, if I want to print it, the encoded text and I can print the encoding. No. So let's try it. So we are passing the same string as before. And basically gives me the encoding. Now, if I want to transform it into an integer and also print the encoding, so because it's so big, we need to, so let's use a big integer. We can't use a integer or even a long. I could parse it, but I don't think it works. So new big integer. Of the encoded with radix of 2. And we need to import big integer from Java math. So let's pass the same thing. So now we basically see that that encoding in big integer is this. Now this will actually take less encoding because basically will, I can actually even show it to you. If I transform it into bytes, so the same big integer, how many bytes does it need of, so we'll get out of this a byte array. And then we'll get its length. So now we basically can even say of these many bytes. So before, we needed basically as many characters that we passed bytes, at least if it's if it's ASCII. If it would have been in, let's say, Chinese characters, would have been much longer than that. So now let's say that we have students, and it basically tells me that I only needed 29 bytes, which I assume that is shorter than this. I can check. So this would have taken me 57 bytes. And obviously we did a compression to 29 bytes. As you have bigger and bigger text, you'll basically get better and better encoding, no? That's it. Basically, this is Huffman Codes. Do you have any questions? You can either ask them or put them in the chat. I saw that a lot of students prefer to put that in the chat because it's easier to ask questions in the chat. If not, let's continue. So this is Huffman 3 encoding. Very, very simple, but very, very good encoding that compresses text into with the help of binary trees. And really we are not using a binary search tree, but we are using a very standard tree. We have a node that has references to other nodes. It's a binary standard binary tree. So another issue that we didn't discuss in detail last time was how to write iterators. So the tree interface that we implemented last time extends the JavaLang iterable interface, which defines the iterator method, which returns an instance of an iterator interface. And this is the iterator, which basically it's an object that provides a uniform way of traversing elements with hasNext that returns a Boolean, next that returns the next element based on the cursor, and remove, which removes the current element, and we can still continue iterating over the rest of the elements. Since BST, our binary search tree implementation last class, is a subclass of abstract tree, and abstract tree implements a tree interface, therefore BST must implement iterable. So we basically need an iterator that will be returned when we call the iterator method. So this iterator method will actually, in our case, return an in-order iterator. It's the standard iterator that visits the left subtree first, then the node, the parent, then the right subtree. And basically, the constructor that we will invoke will be the in-order object. And how do we do it? Basically, what we are going to do, we are going to invoke the in-order method that we defined last class. Basically, it was this recursive method that iterates over objects. And instead of printing the objects that are returned in order, we put them in an array. And then our iterator will basically just start with index 0 in that array and visits the nodes in that array. So that's basically what we are going to do. The iterator object constructs the array using the in-order method. Then it iterates over the elements in the tree using that list. And even if we delete an element, we can basically delete the element in the list and then recall the in-order method, give me the list of elements in order. I don't even need to change the cursor, that integer index, because now it's actually pointing to the next element after the one that I deleted. So really this, when the iterator is created, its current value for the index is 0, which points to the first element in the list. That is the in-ordered list that I obtained from the in-order. If I invoke next, basically I just return the current element at that index and moves the cursor, increments the cursor with 1, the current with 1. The hasNext method checks whether the current index is still less than the length of the list. And the remove method calls the remove method for the element from the tree. And then I call the in order to actually create again the in order list. And the current doesn't need to be changed, it's still the same integer value. So here is the implementation. Basically, the only thing that we need to implement, because we implemented the iterable interface, is an iterator method, which returns a new in-order iterator, which is an inner class to our BST, binary search tree. The in-order iterator implements the Java util iterator for the same parameterized type E, that is the parameterized type of the BST. Then we store internally in a private array list the list of elements, the references to the list of elements in the binary search tree. How do we do it? Easy. We basically just call the method in order. And the in order method traverses the binary tree and stores them the elements in the list. In order calls in order, which calls the in order for the root. And this is just a standard in order method, which basically I'm passing the root of the tree. It has access to the root because this is an inner class to the BST. If the root is null, we return. Basically the array list is empty, still empty. Otherwise, we call first the in order for the left subtree, the left child. Then we add the current element to the list, which will be done also recursively for left and for the right. And this basically populates the array list with the elements in order. So that's basically the methods that create this in order traversal. And then we'll have methods for getting the next element and checking hasNext if the next element exists. So hasNext, basically hasNext takes the current. Basically, the current is initialized to 0. It's just an index starting from 0, an integer index that starts from 0. If the current is less than the size of the list, it returns true. Otherwise, it returns false. We reach with the index the last element. If we call the method next, I basically get list.get current plus plus, which gets the current element and increments the counter with one. So I iterate over lists. I don't have to deal with iterating over the tree itself. I don't do an in order method inside here. I basically already did it and I created an array list for it. The remove method calls the delete method in BST, which deletes the element at the current index from the list. And then I clear the list and I call the in order method one more time to rebuild the list. I don't have to basically modify the current. The current is still the same value. The clear method basically initializes the root with null and sets the size to zero. And this was a method that was in the BST class. We finished the iterator itself. And once we have an iterator, we can iterate with a for each loop. So here is an example in which I created a binary search tree. I inserted various nodes into it, George, Michael, Tom, Adam, Jones, Peter, and Daniel. And with the for each loop, I iterate over every element in that tree. So for each string S in the tree, and this is using the iterator because basically that's what the for each method does. It only works for iterable objects. And I print the strings in that tree. And I implemented it so you can actually see it. I sent it to you last class, I believe. Oh, this is the Huffman coding encoding. This is the BST with iterator. Okay. Let me stop the other program. Okay, so this is the second part that I wanted to cover. The third part is the graphical interface, and I will explain it to you in detail. So it's a tree is a recursive structure. So you need to display it somehow in a graphical user interface. In my case, I will basically have a standard fixed height to which basically the nodes are represented. Then the middle of the current page is set as the position of the root. And then for every position, I increment with half of basically the distance left. So for instance, for the subtree, for the subchildren 25 and 60, I put them at 1/4 because I take the value of the distance, which was initially half of the width, and I add 1/4 of it, half of that. Then when I have the position of the node 25 and the width is 1/4, I'm basically putting the same fixed height and I'm setting the position of 35 as the current position of 25 plus half of the remaining width, which basically gives me this position for the node 35. And I use the same algorithm for every one of the nodes. So the height is always added with a fixed height, but the position of the children will be left of, so minus half of the remaining space for the left child and plus half of the remaining space for the right child. Everything else is a constant. So the height is a constant, the radius of the node is a constant, the positioning of the lines are basically from that position that is computed from the current position. And the displaying is done recursively. So I display the root by stating the position and then and the height. And then I basically find the positions of the left child and the right child. And I call the display method, the display binary tree method recursively for the child, given the position, the remaining space to the left and to the right. And the height is always a constant. Now, this is a standard example of what is called the model view controller. It's a software architectural pattern, which you will basically, I cover in CSC 316 as part of the design patterns in software engineering. And the idea of this design pattern is that You have a view, which basically it's used, it's an object used for visualizing the data, but the data is kept separately in a model. In our case, the model is the binary search tree. It's just a standard binary search tree. The view is the view, the panel in which we visualize the tree. And then we have a controller, which in our case is the main subclass of JavaFX application called BST animation, which basically what it does, it controls or updates the view when the model is updated. So the view through interactions, the user clicks an add button, it updates the model, and the model updates the view. The view is updated based on the model, it's just visualizing the model. The controller deals with the interaction. So it basically captures the update and directs the update in the model. Okay. So the model is used for storing and handling the data. The view is the visual representation of the data, and the controller handles the user interaction, updates the model, and controls the view or updates the view. So it's a quite ingenious way to separate responsibilities. So the controller does event processing, the view visualize the data that is in the model. The model is basically like a database. In some applications, you would see basically this as a tree, that the view connected to the controller, which is connected to the model. But really, I skip the controller in this case because I show that the view is updated directly based on the model. So here is the implementation. So we implement the controller first. BST animation extends the standard JavaFX application class. So by default, we override the method start that takes the primary stage. We create the model, so we create an empty binary search tree. We create a border pane in which we will put the view, which is an instance of a JavaFX panel called BTView that we are actually going to implement it separately. We set this view that we just created in the center of that border pane. If you remember, the border pane has a center, a bottom, and in the bottom, we are going to put a text field for the node that we are going to add. We set the preferred column count to 3. We set the alignment to be baseline right. We create a button for insert and a button for delete. And we add all of this in an H box, which is added also is added in the bottom of our pane, our border pane that we created earlier. So now we add the handlers for the two buttons. Lambda function defines the handler for insert, and another lambda function defines the handler for delete. So for insert, the key integer is basically the key that user enters in the text for the text field. We search for that key in the binary search tree. If it's already in the tree, we just redisplay the same view that we had before, and we said that the status is already in the tree. So if we want to insert a node again in the tree, we don't insert it. If it's not already in the tree, we insert the key into the binary search tree, and then we again redisplay the binary search tree in the view, and we basically put in the status that key was inserted in the tree. So really, the way that you should see this controller is that it captures events, it updates the model, and it directs the view to update. And we do exactly the same for deletion. If someone clicks on the button for delete, then the key variable is assigned the text that was entered in the text field for the key. If we didn't find the node in the tree, we redisplay the view, but we state that the key was not in the tree. if we do find the node in the tree, we basically delete the node and we redisplay the key and we update the status that was that key was deleted from the tree. And we add this pane, this border pane that we created with the center being the BT view and the bottom being the text fields, which basically are put in an horizontal pane. We put it in the current scene, this border pane. We set the title of the primary stage to BST animation. We set the scene to be the scene that we created above, and we show the primary stage. And the main method just calls launch with the current arguments. So now BT view. So BT view is just a JavaFX pane, which also has a reference to the tree. So that was passed from the controller. And it has other values, a constant for the vertical gap and a constant for the radius of the tree. Set status will basically get the text field, adds a new text to the children of the current pane with the text that we just passed as a parameter. And this is set as at 20 by 20 pixels, so the upper right corner. Display tree, first of all, clears the entire tree. So this is an update completely that clears all the children of this pane. And then if the root is different than null, it displays the tree recursively. And it passes four parameters. It passes the current node. In the current tree is the root. It passes half of the width as the position of this node. It passes the constant for the vertical gap. This I could have ignored because it's already defined in the as a constant, as a value in this tree. And I'm passing a quarter of the width as being the distance to which left and right children will be put at. So now we have the main method, display tree. Takes a node, an X coordinate, which tells me where that node will be put, a Y coordinate, which is the height where that node will be put. So at the beginning, this is right below the top of the page at a distance of a vertical distance equal with the vertical distance constant. And the age gap between the current node, the horizontal gap between the current node and its left and right children. If the left child is different than null, then I have to draw a line, which basically I added to the current pane, a new line from X minus the horizontal gap. So the bottom of basically the child, the left child, Y plus the vertical gap. So basically goes down the vertical gap from the current Y value to the position of the current node, X and Y. So basically in this tree that you see here, it will draw from X minus the vertical, minus the horizontal gap and Y plus the vertical gap from this position to X and Y, the parent's position. And then we call recursively display the current left tree node, and we are passing the new value for X, which is X minus vertical gap, the new value for Y, which is Y plus the vertical gap, and half of the current vertical gap. So that will basically tell me how was the distance in horizontal from the node to its left child and right child. It's going to be half of what we currently have. And the same for right child. So basically we force draw the line from the X position and the Y position of the right child to the X position and Y position of the parent. And then we call recursively display tree of the right tree and the position of that node and half of the current vertical gap. For the current node, I draw a circle with the radius, the constant radius and the X and Y coordinates as the center of the circle. I fill it with white I color the stroke with black, and then I add the child a text at the position x minus 4 and y plus 4, which is basically a little bit below to the left of that's the center x. And I basically write the current element. And this is exactly what we are doing here. So in the animation class, I basically, this is a controller and I can add new nodes. So I can insert one. If I want to insert one again, it changes that one is already the status, one is already in the tree. If I want to insert zero, this will be a left child. If I want to insert, let's say, minus one, this will be a left child of zero. And you see that it's half the distance and then half of that previous distance and so on. So I can insert three, I can insert two, I can insert four. If I want to reinsert it, it doesn't. I can delete it. I can delete any node, like for instance, one. And now basically it found the rightmost subchild on the left branch, the rightmost subchild, which was zero, we exchanged to that node, and then it redirected the left branch of the root to that node that we basically wanted. So now if I want to delete, for instance, three, it also, it will delete three, and two becomes the child of zero. Or we deleted two by okay, in this example. And this is the animation part. Any questions? Now for the lab today, what I want you to do, first of all, is to implement another iterator, one that does pre-order, a bidirectional iterator. Basically, well, it's similar to the list iterators that we had in the first lecture on lists in Java util in Java collection framework, which has not only next but also previous. It's quite easy to implement because my iterator basically has next, but all that it does, it increments the current with one. You decrement with the current with one and you basically have a new iterator, and you should provide it as the main iterator for our the BST class. And then have a simple example that iterates with next or iterates with, and from time to time you can go previous. So you show that the iterator also works. Another extension to BST, and not only to BST, you can do it for most like other trees. So the good thing about BST is that if I want to find the path, I can start from the root because I have a single way to go to that object. Because I have to use, it's a binary search tree. I know exactly I'm going on the left branch or I'm going to the right branch based on the value of the key. But if I just have a simple tree, which does is not a binary search tree, if I want to get the path from a leaf to the root, I will have to go on the reverse from the leaf to the root. So what I basically want you to do is to add another data field in the node called parent, which is a reference from the child to the parent, not from the parent to the left or the right child. And then modify basically the rest of the methods to use this parent, specifically get path. Given a node, instead of going with binary search from the root to that node, do it in reverse, go from the pair, the child to the root by using this parent reference and test it. Basically show that indeed, if you basically want the path from a certain node, you can find it in reverse. And finally, implement the Huffman compression. So you can test it and play with it for your own name. So one thing that I basically did was to show you that you can encode a text in using the Huffman encoding. But try to think, how do you decode it? I'm giving you an encoding, like for instance, this encoded, and you want to decode it given this array of codes. So try basically do decoding once you have the encoding in binary. You don't need to do it in integer, the reverse methods here. Just take an encoding and decode it into the original string. And that these are interesting problems about binary search trees. Next class, we are going to do AVL trees, which are basically a very balanced version of binary search trees that gives us logarithmic time for search, insertion, and deletion of elements in the binary search tree. Okay. That's all for the lecture today. Please start working on the lab. I will save the recording and post it on Piazza after the class. And I will wait for questions. You can post them in the chat. I saw that several of you prefer to write questions in the chat instead of asking them loudly, which is great because I can always take them at any moment to respond to them. But today there were no questions.